you so much for coming out this evening, and I want to thank you also for your patience in making sure everyone has a seat. Good work, everybody. Give yourselves a round of applause for being good sports. Yay! Thank you, everyone. My name is Maggie. I'm a librarian here at the Wooster Wayne County Public Library. I work in the Adult Services Division upstairs. I met Aaron when he approached the library and said, I would like to put my bike in one of your giant display cases. And I said, well, yes, please. And also, would you mind telling us a little bit more about it? So it's been a really great experience to meet Aaron and to have him here and to learn about woodworking and bicycling, two things I don't know a lot about. Ask me about 18th century British literature. I gotcha. Woodworking, not so much. So it's going to be a fun night. I hope everyone has had a little refreshment. And Aaron's going to give us his talk. I have here some post-it notes. If you saw the display last month, you saw that Aaron described the pictures with little post-it notes. So we thought that would be a fun theme to carry through. And I have golf pencils. So we can pass these out and write down all of your questions and save them until the end, because I know there's going to be a lot of questions. I had a lot myself. It's a very fascinating talk. And so at the end, we can take questions. Also, Aaron can give you his email.
Sure.
Aaron can give you his email so you can email any questions that we don't get to. We are on a time schedule. All of the bodies in the library need to be out by 8:30 this evening. So I'm going to need to start getting this room closed up by 8:15. So I think we're going to have a lot of fun in the next hour and a half. Okay? All right. So let's get these going.
No, not even moving.
I know. Is it me?
I don't know. It's a magnetic personality. It's called magnetic.
Take some, pass them down. Pencils are coming. All right. And without further ado, Aaron Holmes, the man who built a bike from wood.
I was really excited to put my bike into the display case down there, and then when Maggie asked about doing a presentation, I thought, well, that sounds like fun. During the process of building the bike, I took many, many pictures. So as a lot of people that know me would say, I typically like to document things that are going on by taking a picture, so I've got that one. I wanted to start off by asking, how many people are interested in cycling? I see a lot of my cycling, wow, that's an incredible brand. A lot of my cycling friends out there, a lot of people I know from riding bikes together, people that are interested in woodworking. Yeah, that's what I expected. There was a little bit of crossover sometimes too. Maybe people that are interested in designing or creating things. I know there's a lot of creative people out here too. So welcome to you all. Thank you for coming to my presentation tonight. Just a quick overview. The first couple slides, a lot of talky talk, not as many pictures. Then after that, we're going to launch into pictures that illustrate this process of designing this bicycle, the process of building it, and then I'll show you some pictures from the first ride. So I expect that to take maybe 45 to 60 minutes. If I see people dozing off, I will accelerate. First things first, why build a wood bicycle? I think that's a fair question. I think that's maybe the most common question I got at the beginning. And the answer to that is I started cycling back in probably 2003. And I know there's a lot of faces that I met back about that time frame. Really got into the sport of cycling, really loved the motion of it, I love the exercise, I love the thinking part of it as well. Shifting gears, cornering, the sensation of motion, all my cycling friends here probably thinking that that appeals to them also. The years continue with my interest in cycling. Is there anything I can do about the microphone? The years continued on, and like a lot of things that I've become interested in, inevitably, I want to make something. I want to do something with my hands. I want to build something that goes along with my bike. For example, the wheel-chewing stand over here. Oh, I'm not going to go buy a wheel-chewing stand. I'm going to build a wheel-chewing stand. So as the time went on, I started to think, I'd really like to build a bicycle. So build a bicycle, right? The deal is I grew up in a wood shop. There's my dad sitting back there, and from a very young age, I breathed a lot of sawdust, and I enjoyed woodworking, and that's what I knew. So building a bicycle in a conventional way, with steel, titanium, or what have you, wasn't something that I had experience with. So it turned into, wait a minute, maybe I could build a wood-framed bicycle. So the second question, well, how in the world do you build a wood-framed bicycle? There's experts around for building bikes, and I'll call it the conventional way. I didn't really know about anybody that was building wood-framed bikes until I went to NABS. The North American Handmade Bicycle Show was in Louisville, Kentucky a couple years ago. And as I was cruising the aisles, checking out just an incredible display of creativity and fabrication, and I came across a guy named Jay Kinzinger, who's actually a mechanical engineering professor at Cedarville. I thought, hey, Cedarville, Ohio, that's not too far away. And we struck up a conversation, and I was looking at his wood frame bikes. And I think, you know, maybe he understood or realized my passion for the idea of it. So he said, hey, if you ever want to build one, let me know. I can provide some information to you, I can coach you along. I thought that sounded like a really generous offer, and indeed that is how the project came to be, is by working with him and understanding some of the design ideas that he had developed, and then he was able to do testing in a lab. He made that part of a senior design project, and that's pretty convenient, right? So a senior design project for some of his students was to do the testing of the wood frames, and he was able to demonstrate that they could pass all of the safety and durability tests that would be expected of a bicycle frame. So now that I had the idea, I had the support, the next question was, well, what type of bike am I going to build? And all those cyclists raised their hands, so start thinking about it. We've got our road bikes, our cyclocross bikes, our gravel bikes, our mountain bikes, and there's other categories in there. I wasn't sure at first exactly what type of bike I wanted to build. In some ways, I thought, well, what bikes do I currently own, and then, maybe what kind of niche could I fill? And I started thinking about what I'll end up calling a touring bike. And I came into the fire department one day to meet with Rody Walters back here. We'll talk more about how groovy this project was in a little bit. And I talked to him about this older idea of randonneuring, and he said, you mean a touring bike? And he started to explain to me what some aspects of a touring bike or randonneuring bike would be. And that's what I settled on then. It's like, I want a drop bar road bike. I want it to be comfortable. I want it to be something that I can ride long distances. I didn't want anything terribly aggressive about it. I wanted it to be fairly conservative in terms of the geometry and the handling, particularly thinking about the time I was going to invest into it. Just didn't seem like it was a time to be risky on that part. So let's get started. Here we go. We're going to design and build a wood frame bike. At least the approach that I took, one of the first things I was thinking about was components. I started thinking about exactly what type of handlebar, saddle, and some of that was necessary in order to get into the actual design. And the wheels ended up being one of the main features that I designed the bike around. So these are 650B wheels for a lot of us on our road bikes. They're 700C wheels. I'll call that the normal or the full size road wheel. These are a smaller wheel because, as you can see, the tires are much higher volume. So the outside diameter of these smaller wheels but higher volume tires is about the same as what our 700C by maybe a 23 millimeter tire would give. So Daniel, sitting back here, my wheel building helper buddy, we started to lace up some wheels. We were using the truing stand over there. That was one of the first things we did to get started on the project. Here's the wheel, or the tires. I should have pointed out the little yellow post-it note. So if you have questions along the way, maybe you would want to note them down, or every once in a while I want to throw out something as an interesting point that maybe for cyclists in this case, compass tires. Most of us probably never heard of compass tires. If you want to do some research or some homework, Jan Heine, H-E-I-N-E, I believe, is the guy, and you can read until you're tired of reading about low trail geometry and higher volume road tires and that question of are they efficient or not efficient, more efficient, that's where you can find that. Or at least one person's opinion, let's put it that way. So now it's time to start designing the frame. We're gonna use CAD. I hadn't used AutoCAD in many, many years, so I needed to do a refresher, and I found LibreCAD. Who speaks Spanish? Libre, free CAD. I found the free CAD program. So Daniel and I sat down. I think he's designing a new shop for me to build in the backyard. No, he's designing a doghouse over there, and I was working on designing a bicycle frame. So, like a lot of things that I tackle, I really like to dig into the details. I like to do some work, analyze it, make some notes, consult with people that are more of an expert than I am, for sure, and start to decide, well, what am I doing here? What things do I need to look at? So, I think I was sitting in my car at lunch one day doing that last summer. Here we have at least a small representation of the CAD design. So you can see the frame itself is up here, and some of the colors aren't showing up so well, but the wheels, the tires are shown. So I started to look at things that Rody had talked to me about, bottom bracket drop, length for wheelbase, length out to the fork. I was working with stack and reach, a couple numbers that can help us understand if a bike is going to fit us properly. And I really patterned this off of two road bikes that I currently own. So I have what I'll call an aggressive road bike, and then I have a cross bike. So yeah, all you guys that know me, there's the light speed, and then there's the orange black mountain, right? So those two bikes, I sat beside each other, and I kind of picked the traits that I liked best about each of them. And in some ways, I would consider this to be a hybrid of those two bikes in terms of the fit. So this is where things got really interesting for me. Okay, we're sitting on top of our bike, and we look down, and we see the chain, and we see our feet moving. Do you ever hit your heel on your seat stays, your chain stays? Yeah, that can happen. I mean, sometimes we have to adjust our pedaling stroke for that. Well, there's an incredible amount of design that goes into that particular area of the bike, and that's what I learned. It really gave me an appreciation for looking at some of the plus-size tire bikes or the fat bikes, and really take a hard look at one sometime and ask yourself, how in the world did they fit that all in there? I was asking myself that question on these even less voluminous tires. So these are cross sections. If you're looking down on the chain stays or looking into the back on the seat stays, and you can see I was working off of, you know, what my wheelbase was, what my chain stay lengths were, represented, say, in the green slim box up there is the actual chain ring. So the chain ring needs to have clearance to the chain stay. The crank arm needs to have clearance to the chain stay. Well, then ultimately your foot is going to sit on a pedal and you don't want your heel to strike as well. So this was really mind-blowing to me in a way about how much detail goes just into that portion of the bicycle frame design. So after I thought I had a design, I made full-size drawings. Those full-size drawings of the frame of the, I'm going to use a couple of terms, the main triangle being what you see here as the largest main triangle of the bicycle frame. I made patterns for those. So the full-size drawings are attached to plywood, and then you can see that these patterns were cut out. Main triangle is what I'll refer to that as I continue forward. Up until now, I hadn't even talked about wood, right? Okay, so now I can speak to the woodworkers and get them excited. Four-quarter black walnut. Yoder lumber. If you get up at like 5:30 in the morning and you drive south of Millersburg, the Amish guys will be in there. They open at 6. You can pick up 3 or 4 walnut boards, hop back in your car, and still be at work by 7:30. That's the way to do it. So you can see I started off, you know, people often ask, well, how much wood did it take? This is mostly representative here. These boards in the back of my Mazda 3, so this isn't some giant SUV, but these are about 6 foot long boards. There were two 12-inch wide boards, 10 to 12 inches wide, and then another board that was around 6 inches wide. So we're gonna make the main triangle of the bike now, but we're not just gonna take those boards and chunk out solid pieces. We wouldn't have the strength that we would need from doing that. As you can picture a bike going down the road, bouncing down the road, let's say we pedal really hard down Moreland Hill and you bottom out at the bottom as you start to accelerate, there are all kinds of forces that are happening, particularly at the head tube down here at the bottom bracket junction, and of course up here in this junction as well. So in order to handle those forces, we're going to make our own custom plywood, is essentially what it comes down to. So we know that if you stand a board up and the grain runs a certain direction, if you wanted to, you could split it and it would split apart, right? Well, if we start changing the angle of those pieces, we can increase the strength. So now there's no single direction that would be a splitting force. So this is getting started on resawing this lumber to make my own plywood. Here you see the plies that are coming out of a surface planer. These were about 5 to 6 millimeter plies. And there's a whole stack of them up here in the corner. On a happy day in the winter last year, I remember I rode down to Dad's shop on the bike, so I just thought that was kind of fun to see my orange bike sitting there next to these plies that hopefully would become a wood frame bicycle. It wasn't necessary at all, but I really kept track of the individual plies and how they went together. So the bike is actually, this is a little nutty I guess, but it is very, very symmetrical side to side. When I split a piece and then cut a piece and decide which, it was built in two halves, so decide which was going to be a left or a right, they're mirror images on the left and the right half of the bike. So the lamination layers, as I alluded to, there's two halves of the main triangle. It's called left half, right half. Each half is comprised of four layers. So here you see the four layers. And it might be a little bit tough to spot it, but pick an area of the bike. Let's pick the bottom bracket down here. Look up at the top picture, you see where the joint is. Move over to layer two, and you can see that that joint has been offset. Now it's a vertical joint over here, it was a semi-horizontal joint over here. Come down to this picture, now you see that the way the pieces go together, there's quite the staggering or shifting of the grain and the wood. Same way over to the fourth layer. The other one that I always like to look at is up there in layer two, the triangle up at the head tube. So we know that that's a high stress area, so there is actually some pieces of wood in there where the grain is running at a 45 degree angle back towards the rider. So that's where the strength of the plywood laminations comes from. So there they are stacked up. I've got a left half, I've got a right half. We're now getting ready to actually glue those halves or those laminations together. So some prep work here. The piece that I showed you a little bit ago was used as a pattern, and you see two backer boards in the upper left picture. So those backer boards are what I'm going to lay up my laminations on. Some key features to keep track of everything, that bottom bracket joint, I'm actually using a Forstner bit to mark the center of that hole. And then there's pins, and actually when I brought these pieces in tonight, I realized the pins are still sticking out. I might have dropped them in the parking lot. Those pins were used as a locating feature so that I could keep track of how those halves would later go together. Lower right picture is showing epoxy. I don't know if anybody's worked with epoxy or worked with West Systems epoxy. That's a bit of a departure from what I had learned from Jay Kinzinger, the guy that had built the wood frame bikes. He was using Type Bond 3. The research that I was doing and making some calls and talking with West Systems, I actually decided to go with the West Systems epoxy. So that's a two-part epoxy. If you've ever used that stuff, make sure you get those dispensing pumps, because it's pretty ridiculous if you had to measure it out each time. And let's get a little bit into the laminating method. This emphasizes the dispensing pumps. The way that I did this, here is layer one, and that is the outermost layer. So that's what you're sitting here looking at on the outside of the frame. To limit the penetration of the epoxy, the two-step method is used. So you mix that epoxy, it's a slow cure epoxy. You know, some people maybe have used the 5-minute stuff. Well, that absolutely would work in this application. This is more like a 5 to 6 hour cure. Mix the epoxy, put it on with a roller, and allow it to tack up. And when it tacks up, it starts to cure. And what that means is that when you come back with the second coat, it's not going to soak into the grain as much. And that's important because if you applied the epoxy and then immediately laminated it with high clamping pressure, you would very likely squeeze all the epoxy out of those layers. So we needed to limit that potential for a dry joint, is what they call that. So with the two-step method, I would apply the epoxy, and I only did two layers at a time. So two layers for the left, two layers for the right, and then they get clamped between those backer boards that I mentioned earlier. When I was a kid, Dad said all he ever wanted for a gift was clamps. And that really came in handy on this project. So when those pieces were cured, I went back a day later, 24 hours later. I would take those two halves apart. There was wax paper that I put in between. The epoxy doesn't stick to the wax paper. So you open up those two halves on the backer boards, and then I do some sanding just to kind of remove some of that residual epoxy that was in there. And then it was on to the next layer. So I would add layer three. I would apply the two-step method for the epoxy. You see the upper right picture with the pins. I'm using those to orient things. And I guess an advantage of having all of that quote-unquote scrap wood, I could shoot brads into these layers and the parts that wouldn't become the bike frame. So you can imagine how messy this was. You know, you're wearing gloves and everything's buttered up with epoxy, and you press together here and things sort apart over there. Well, using a brad nailer is what allowed me to kind of keep things together and keep everything intact. That, and also recognizing that epoxy is able to fill some gaps. But in an obsessive compulsive way, I didn't really have any gaps. Somebody mentioned lessons learned earlier. That's a term we use at work a lot. You know, lessons learned, well, one of them would be don't be so obsessive about some of those gap ideas. The epoxy can fill that. So at this point, we have our two halves. These are all four layers. They don't exactly look like a bike frame so much, but we're about to change that. The internal work is what happened next, and that hopefully is not too much of a disappointment, but there's steel tubes inside my wood frame. As it turns out, the head tube requires bearings to be pressed into it. The seat tube requires a seat post to slide in, as well as a bottom bracket that houses those bearings to be threaded in place. So it was necessary, once again following the methodology that Jay has used over the years, it was necessary to put a steel tube into the seat post here, and a steel tube into the head tube. There are no steel tubes in the middle though. The picture there at the bottom, a router set up with a box core bit, and I was able then to follow my internal cavity pattern, which is this one. So have a look at that afterwards, and there's all kinds of cool notes on there. I'm not sure what all I was writing, but keeping track of things. Run the router inside of that pattern, and I'm able to carve out the area for the tubes. My beautiful assistant, Helen, was able to help me with coping or mitering the seat tube to match up with the bottom bracket shell. So that was just one joint, and I printed a template off. There's definitely templates you can find for making those types of joints. That's what you see wrapped around the tube with paper. And like I alluded to earlier, this is where the project got a little groovy. Rudy was generous to help me out with the actual welding of the seat tube to the bottom bracket, and he also taught me some important lessons about externally butted seat tubes. So I got that back home and slotted for my seat post. I think everybody's probably seen that on their bike before. If you got an aluminum or a steel frame bike, there's usually a slot back there when you tighten your clamp that allows the metal to flex a little bit without fracture. And then in the lower left picture, you see I started to remove some material. It's really not entirely necessary to have this tube go the entire length, from what I learned from Jay. For myself, I decided I'm going to make it go the entire length, but I'm going to take some material out of it. I should say this project really wasn't about creating a lightweight bike in any kind of way, but I couldn't help it. I took some material out. So there's holes that were perforated within this section of the seat tube, and then certainly the head tube was also perforated as well. Here you see them laying there with the two blanks, the left half, the right half. There's the tubes. By this point in time, I've done a lot of fitting to make sure that they would drop into place. And then also of interest, the cavity that's routed out here in the bottom. I guess at the time I took the picture, I had not yet routed the cavities in the top tube, but there are cavities there as well. So I was joking around earlier. I'm not musical, so I don't know what kind of notes those are, but those indeed are the hollow wood tubes. And a lot of times when people ask me, well, is it solid, is it not, I tap on it like that, and everybody usually says, oh yeah, it's hollow there. So you're seeing it from the inside. Okay, so let's get the external shape of our frame going. Grab a jigsaw and cut it out. It kind of is that simple. there's been talk about, CNC, and you could use that. Yeah, and certainly you could if you're building more than one, or if you already had a CNC or access to one. Yeah, that would probably be a way to go. For me, the old Bosch jigsaw got the job done. What is it that sculptors always say? Wow, how'd you make that amazing sculpture of that man? Well, you just take away everything that's not a man, and you're left with a sculpture of a man. That's what I was thinking in this lower right picture. I sat back and looked at it and thought, now there's the pile of scraps sitting on the table up here too. Wow, so that's kind of everything that's not part of a bike frame. At that point in time, the backer board was still attached. I think when I took this picture, I had pried the backer board off. So maybe you noticed the backer boards were covered with a brown paper, and the epoxy and all that stayed up above that. And then I was able to split the black walnut from the backer board at that brown paper junction. So there's maybe two or three pictures that are just really notable in my mind, where there were moments where I stood back and just said, wow, I can't believe it, I'm making a bike. This is actually starting to feel like a bike. And this is one of them right here, just seeing those two main triangles of the frame. You can see they're really chunky, they're really blocky at this point. There's no shape to them on the outside, but it kind of came alive to me that I was really making a frame at this point. Back in the shop, following the patterns with some router bits. So you can see the jigsaw cut probably wasn't super, super precise. It didn't need to be. I was able to use a pattern maker's bit to follow my template. Then you can see down here, I'm spinning, I think it was a 3/4 inch radius roundover bit to start to get some of the profiling of the external shapes. Very much still working with two halves at this point, left half and a right half. That moment over there just felt really scary for some reason. I stood the frame up on the table saw and trimmed off the excess. At several places on the blanks, there was excess pieces mainly for locating. So at the top and bottom of the head tube, then there was also one at the top of the seat tube. I don't know, sometimes you just gotta go for it, right? And that was definitely a lesson of this project, because it was quite a bit more abstract than things I had made in the past. I just started to learn, yeah, you just gotta go for it sometimes. I mean, come up with the best plan that you know how. Don't do anything maybe without thinking it through first, but ultimately, I just had to go for it. I think in the top picture here is where I'm cutting off some of those other locating tabs as well. So as I sort of mentioned earlier, a very stressful or critical joint is down here at the bottom bracket. I think it's easy to picture that with pedaling forces and the way that you move and the bike moves and the power that you're putting through the bike pedals, to get some extra strength at that joint, a shoulder was cut. I'm not sure if that's all that easy to see, but you can see the hole that would be the bottom bracket, and you see a ledge at the top of it. That's a shoulder that the chainstay would be able to locate into. So that would be easier for assembly, it'd be easier to fixture things, and then ultimately it provides a stronger joint than if it had not been done that way. Just some other random pictures here. The one in the lower right, who has a Craig jig? Actually, somebody asked me at that work today about that. A Craig jig, you drill those low angle holes, right? Well, I wanted to run the cables through the frame. I thought, oh, it's kind of like a Craig jig. If I can drill a low angle hole, I can come into the frame and then I can pop out somewhere else. The Craig jig wasn't low angle enough, so you'll be able to think it through. Get crafty with a block of wood, drill a hole and bandsaw it in half at an angle, glue it back together, and you'll have a drilling guide for a low angle hole like that. So everything up to now has been talking about the main triangle. We haven't talked about the seat stays and the chain stays a whole lot. So let's jump back to that. We got some more black walnut here. This stock was a little bit thicker, and it's being re-sawn into thin plies. These are about 1/4 inch thick plies, and there would ultimately be 5 of them. That would make up a left and a right seat stay, and then 5 layers that would make up a left and a right chain stay. You can see them set out there to the right, and then I think we were chatting with this a little bit before the presentation started. How did you bend those into shape? And if you wander by at the end, the pieces up here are actually scraps from this process, but the plies were set into a bending jig. So on a bandsaw, I basically cut out the shape that I wanted, working off of my CAD drawing. The plies were stacked in between there. You see my white triangle. I think the woodworkers know that trick, right? If you've got some boards set out and you want to later remember the order that they were, mark a triangle across them, and then you can't confuse the pieces. So I should have mentioned earlier, even in choosing my plies on the main triangle and also in choosing my plies back here, I always picked the nicest looking pieces of walnut to be on the exterior. So that's why I was making sure that I preserved that sequence. And then once again, thanks Dad for all the clamps. So they're clamped up tight over there. That was interesting. Buttered them up the same way. I did the same two-step method to try to limit the penetration of that second application of epoxy. Clamped them together, whole bunch of squeeze out, let them sit like that for a day or even longer. And this is the point where it doesn't show up in the presentation, but I will confess to an issue. One of those chainstays, I rushed a little bit. It was just one of those, the times that I was able to work on the project, and I came back down, I took one out of a form, as it turns out, early, one theory. Or I had too much squeeze out, and I ended up with a dry joint, is my other theory. One of my chainstays popped back open a couple days later, which really was not that confidence-inspiring. But it was also a good lesson in problem-solving, right? So I remade one of those chainstays. I talked to the folks at West System Epoxy, and they kind of said, yeah, your two theories are probably good. After that, and that's why some of these scraps are still around, I spent a lot of time with these trying to flex them and trying to crack them and break them and see if they would pop apart. And they never did, and so far they never have on the bike earlier. But yeah, I guess those things can happen, right? These pieces take on the shape that was necessary for the clearances we talked about earlier with the tire, with the cranks, with the chain ring, with your heel cut out on the bandsaw. Here they are sitting out. So one part of the bike that we really haven't mentioned at all, the dropouts. Doesn't mean that the bike didn't do well in school. The dropouts are these metal pieces at the back. So cyclists, we know when you're taking your rear wheel, you're in and out, there's the dropouts, right? There's lawyer lips on them nowadays, but they used to just be flat and you could really easily drop a wheel out. On this bike, those pieces are metal. And literally I'd done all of that woodwork and then came back, had some general idea about what the geometry of those dropouts needed to be, but then it was back to the computer, back to do some CAD work to understand how this was all gonna work. Early on, I decided I was going to use disc brakes. I don't know, there's a lot of debate about disc brakes on road type of bikes. For me, it was a bit of a problem solver. I was more comfortable with the idea of the braking forces being constrained between the two legs of the dropout as opposed to having the braking forces going through my wood frame. I don't know if that's a valid concern or not, but hey, in the idea of minimizing some variables, that's the way I chose to do it on this bike. So in the upper right corner, you see CAD drawing, I think 51 millimeters, 52 millimeters apart is the spacing hole to hole for the caliper mount. There's the size of the rotor, a 160 millimeter rotor. So that's kind of the geometry that goes into making the design for the dropouts. Version one, let's use plywood, not metal. Attach it to the caliper mount, the rotor, the wheel, and find out that that did not work. Version two, another set from plywood. Attach that. Yeah, there's an interference issue. Version 3, I am learning each time, but version 3 had a different issue. We're on to version 5, and that ultimately was the version of the design that worked. Really what I was doing is I kept shifting the caliper lower. At first I thought it could really straddle between the two legs of the dropout, but needing to have the adjustment to position the caliper once the bike was built, I didn't have it with those earlier designs. So I think there's a lesson there, and yeah, let's not invest all of our effort until maybe we've done a prototype or a mock-up. My dad has definitely suggested before that certain things, why didn't you make that out of poplar as a test run first? And yeah, there's some validity in that idea. Okay, so for the next few slides, what would you do different? I probably wouldn't do any of this again. I had this somewhat romantic idea that if I'm building a hand-built bicycle, that even the metal parts are going to be handmade. So this steel disc here is 4140 pre-hardened chrome moly. Guess what it did to my jigsaw blades when I first did it. So I grabbed an angle grinder, and now you see it happening. And I'm still kind of foolish in this fact that when I work on some of this stuff, I'm out in the backyard, like down on the ground, or maybe down on a knee. And I think a lesson in life that I'm learning is don't work down low like that. Get a more proper setup. I should have set up some sort of temporary workbench or something. But with some perseverance, I was able to hack these out with an angle grinder. It didn't stop there. Now we needed to shape them. So between a bench grinder and, see Rick, I told you I had the same belt sander. And as we talked, mine blew up on me too. I got it working again, and that's how I continued to shape those dropouts. Then it was a matter of all of the areas where I needed to remove material, or I needed a hole. That hole could be for the axle itself, it could be for the mounting of the rear derailleur. I drilled all of those holes, once again based upon the CAD layout, and good old Dremel. it was kind of one of those tests of patience and work on it a little bit at a time. And at 9:30 at night, when other people might be tempted to watch something on TV, I'd go play with my dropouts and grind holes out of them with a Dremel. And obviously, after the Dremel work, there was a ton of filing to get them to the refined shape that you see over there on the right. Now, the way that I chose to attach those to the wood frame is essentially a half lap. So if we're thinking of a piece of wood, if we cut a notch out of it and the dropout keyed in place. So you can see that I roughened that metal surface over there on the right, just to give the epoxy some more ability to light. Let's talk about assembly of the bicycle frame. Somebody had asked me about this earlier, something about the dish of the rear wheel and the alignment of things, and this tactic of using this assembly jig was to make sure that everything came out in proper alignment. So I built the frame, I attached the chain and seat stays on the jig. The jig in this case, it's wood, of course, it's wood, we built a wood bike, right? So the fork drops on to this bolt up here at the front. You can kind of see the cradle in the middle that would hold the main triangle of the bike by the bottom bracket. And then the chain stays back here with the dropouts bolted to the jig. So this was really tedious, and I'm sure I could have used some different techniques maybe to help with this, but I did a lot of hand fitment to get the stays carved away in order to accept the dropout. And I was really trying to get some really nice lines, really minimal gaps. And once again, epoxy, it's a bit forgiving in that regard. You know, it will fill some of those gaps, but I'm actually really, really pleased with the result there. Earlier, the West Systems epoxy, 302 epoxy with a 206 hardener, let's just call that their quote-unquote normal epoxy. When it came to attach these pieces to the frame, I used a different type of epoxy from West Systems. If anybody's used epoxy, you know, you spread it out on something to mix it, maybe a piece of paper or a glossy piece of paper. Later when it hardens, if you pick it up, it's brittle. It snaps, right? It fractures apart. This type of epoxy, it has more of an elastic property to it. So when you mix it on something, you can later then flex it, and it doesn't break, it doesn't snap. And it seemed to me, and from talking with the tech support people there, that at these joints, I just pictured, you know, the cycling or fatigue cycling of the wood of that joint over time. So it seemed like it'd be a good use of this alternative type of epoxy. West Systems, by the way, has an incredible amount of information on their website and their tech support. I think, truth be told, you pay a little bit more for their product, but their tech support is very readily available. I talked to a couple different guys there on the phone with emails, very responsive. So here you see the bike on the frame jig. You see all these joints have been made, and you see clamps at all those places where the chain seat stays were attached. Once again, everything is in proper alignment. Even if there is some variation between the left side and the right side with the chain stays, which there is, I know that, this would accommodate for it, because the rear axle and the front axle with the jig are held in proper alignment. So I guess just some close-ups of some of those joints. Up here at the top where the seat stays come up, they're laid on the outside, but I also went ahead and cut a pocket into the main frame of the triangle. At one point I had a picture of that. I'd taken and made a little template, and then I could use a router with a template bit, and I could cut a pocket into the main frame. It's only a couple millimeters deep, but once again, just being conservative in the design and the approach, I felt like that would allow the chain stays to recess in a little bit and get some actual mechanical strength as opposed to just the epoxy joint. You can see the bottom bracket down below, the dropouts at the rear, and then you get to see the inside of the dropout. I also realized at this point that I should have cleaned up some of that squeeze out while it was still wet. Just in my mind, I thought, well, I'll be doing a lot of sanding later, so what's it matter? The issue is when you get into some of these little tight corners, sanding epoxy is difficult. The epoxy's hard, the wood's soft. It's hard to get your efforts to focus on the epoxy without affecting the wood. So, in the previous pictures, it kind of looked like it was together. Well, it's back apart again. It's still two halves. I don't know, this maybe wasn't exactly how I pictured that I would do this, but it's just kind of the way that it felt like it was working out. I didn't attach the two halves yet. They were clamped together, the pins were locating them, so I definitely had confidence that I wasn't going to lose my position or anything like that. that. So taking it back apart allowed me to work on the bench here, and actually what I was doing in that picture was cleaning up that epoxy squeeze out. The bottom bracket area, I used a bit of an unexpected method there. I didn't cut it to its full size at first. I came back later and could use a pattern bit on the router and more details there, but long story short, it gave me some more confidence that it was aligned properly, and in fact it was, because when I clamped the two halves together, the bottom bracket, it passed through. In other words, it fit on the left side, it fit on the right side. It was in alignment. There was not an excessive gap, because as it sits today, that is a visible part of the bike frame if you look close. The internal pockets in the lower right picture, just for good measure, I went ahead and sealed those with shellac. I don't know if that was necessary or not. I really wanted to put like a fortune cookie paper in there. Something that said, if you're reading this, that means his plans didn't work out. His engineering was poor, I don't know what to say exactly, but I ended up not putting anything in there. Okay, so we have a left half, we have a right half. They're sitting there on the bench. Messy epoxy again, grab your gloves, butter everything up. The tubes themselves have been scuffed. You see here, I'll come back to it in a second, but you see the internal tube. We'll look at that here in a minute. So let's go ahead and put the two halves together. In this case, the steel tubes actually helped locate things. So when the left half and right half went together, the head tube kind of helped make that joint line up properly. I might have still been using my pins, but I really don't think it was necessary at that point. Things went together pretty well. Lower right corner, that's my clamp collection for the moment. You see the need for it just to make sure that you're getting good uniform clamping pressure on the two halves of the frame. Here's the internal tubes. My father-in-law, who lives up in New Hampshire, else I'm sure he would have been here, has always said this is one of his favorite features of the bike. It's pretty cool the way that a tube passes in and it pops out at another part of the bike. Cut them flush and sand them smooth, and it definitely gives kind of a neat look just to see that. You can look at that if you come up to the bike later. Essentially, the cables that go to the rear of the bike both come in on the left half. One of them crosses over and comes out on the right side. The other stays on the left side, and they both come out to the back. That was one of those times, I mean, you guys have had it before too, you're doing a project and you're thinking, is this really going to be worth it or not? Should I put the effort into that? But remember that picture you have in your head that's kind of driving you forward, and oh yeah, that's going to be worth it. And that's the way it was for those internal cable routings. So here's a bike frame. Remember I said the real specific pictures in my mind, the really big moments of excitement, it's actually the one on the right is the one that sticks in my mind. Just the frame was stood up. I think I was doing some sanding on the back side of that bottom bracket joint, and by golly, it was a bike frame at that point. And like any good project, you always have to purchase a tool as part of doing that project to justify your tool purchase, and thanks honey, I bought the Orbitus sander there. The metal that was used to make the dropouts, I decided I better paint it. So that was masked off in a rather tedious fashion. I'm not sure that there's another way to do that, just because of all the sanding that happened. It seems like this is the way, you know, just to mask it off and be able to paint those silver type of color. Sanding and shaping and sanding and sanding and sanding and sanding and sanding. We know that from our woodworking projects, right? You know, sometimes you cringe a little bit when you get to that part of the project, but you gotta suck it up and make a lot of dust. So, a neat little thumb plane that Dad had down in the shop is what I used to develop that radius on the top tube. And then just really a lot of time with either a sander or some sort of plane to really start to get the shapes. The pins that were used for locating, I never really considered those part of a design component, but afterward I figured I'd maybe fill in those holes with epoxy. I decided I kind of like those pins, so I got some aluminum, and you can see it in the bike. People have asked me about that before too. They say, well, what are these dots here? Well, those are actually the aluminum pins that are pushed through the holes that were used for the alignment, and then they're trimmed and sanded flush. It's kind of one of those little details that I kind of look at favorably. So there it is, the bike frame sitting out in the front yard in a naked wood kind of way, ready for finish. Finish! didn't go quite that fast, but I thought that was a nice A-B comparison. For finishing, has anybody used Birchwood Casey Troop Oil? Has anybody heard of that? For, I think, gun stocks is the common application. So that's what I started to look for. I thought, okay, what is made of walnut that really has a beautiful finish on it? And you can find a lot of different options there, of course, but then starting to read about the people doing gun stock refinishing, I thought, you know, that really applies well, because a gun stock is being used, it's being carried, it's being dropped, it needs touched up over time. So as opposed to some sort of like film building finish, I really started to like the idea of the oil finish. Birchwood Casey, I can give my endorsement to, because I called them up and it seemed like they were really excited to talk about something other than gun stocks. So speaking about a bike frame, which of course they never heard of that application, they were able to give some guidance. And when it comes down to it, I applied True Oil, maybe 6 to 7 coats, with my finger. And that's what they recommend as well. You don't need to use a brush, you don't need to use a pad or anything. It's literally wiped on. Which I thought there was some security in doing it that way, because less of a chance it drips, runs, sags, and then something that's not, you know, more typically flat. I thought that was important. So I was really pleased with this product. And then we talked a lot about, well, how would we freshen it up? Over time, there's going to be chips and dings, and I'm sure there already is, on that down tube in particular. So at some point, if it starts to lose some of its luster, or if there's nicks and scratches, dip a finger and I'll start to touch it up with the True Oil. Cyclist friends, we talk about building up a bike. I'm building up a bike. I'm building up a 29er. I'm building up a cross bike. I've done that on 5 or 6 or 7 different bikes. I really get excited about the building up part. Well, let me tell you, it was even more exciting when it was a frame that I made myself. So here it is sitting at my cycling workbench. It's clamped into the work stand and I'm starting to add the components to it. Another picture that sticks in my mind is that picture on the right that is actually sitting on my desk at work still. It's a frame. The contrast maybe isn't so good here, but it's a frame with a C-post, handlebar stem, no pedals, no chain. It's rolling on wheels. So I kind of call that my rolling chassis picture. And I remember I was in the basement and I hopped onto it and I pushed off and realized I have no brakes and no means to stop, nor do I have anything to put my feet on, which is not so comfortable on a bike seat. Yeah. And I remember doing that a couple times back and forth just to kind of get the feel for it, right? Did I really understand anything about the feel for it from that? Probably not, but it just kind of added to the experience, I guess. Somebody had asked about the handlebar tape. So of all things, I considered a lot of different options about the aesthetics of the bike, about the color, the saddle being leather, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Handlebar tape. I found out about this method. Read that it's like an older French method for wrapping handlebars. They would wrap it in a cotton tape. So the yellow, you know, canary, big bird yellow, that's the color of that tape, is hanging there and it's as floppy as you can imagine for a cotton fabric tape. Wrap the bars with it, and then come back with some shellac. And this really caught my attention, right? For woodworkers, shellac is a really old type of finish, a hand-applied type of finish, and I thought it was really cool that I was going to use shellac to cover my handlebars. So it's an amber shellac, and what you see start to happen, the left half versus the right half, is it started to change the color of that yellow tape. And there's examples online, you can look at different people's examples of shellacking bars, and you can start to get an idea about what color it's going to turn for a certain base layer tape and then a certain type of shellac. So as you can see, I don't know if there's another picture, but from looking at the bike, I think 3 to 4 coats later, that amber shellac really started to cause the handlebars to match the saddle. I thought that was pretty neat. And that's another easily repairable finish. I think I mentioned earlier the bike fell over at one point in time and got scuffed up on the left side. The handlebars in particular, I kind of like it because now I can prove that the handlebar tape is canary big bird yellow. You can see it on that side, but if I wanted to, I could easily freshen that up with shellac. It's a real, real grippy feel. Cyclists, make sure you walk by and feel it. Personally, I always ride with gloves on, so that roughness didn't bother me. I like the small diameter. It has not been slippery when wet, because the time I rode it to work, the guys that remember that, yeah, I came in like a wet puppy that morning. I got drenched on the way to work. My first big appearance at work to ride the bike in, and I got soaked on the way in. But the handlebar grip was excellent. some extras. There's probably even more than this, but just a couple things that come to mind. So I would encourage you also, when you're working on your project, you know, keep that vision alive. Keep thinking about, well, what other feature could I add? What other artistic creativity could I express in my project? These cranks are old Shimano BioPace cranks that I bought off eBay at a cheap price. So BioPace, I think, was the time when they did the non-round chainring. They were doing the egg-shaped chainring. Somebody was selling just the crank arms. So I milled a slot in them and embedded a piece of walnut. Hey, if it's a wood bike and there's metal components on it, that's great. Let's spice them up a little bit to, you know, stick with the theme. So I was pretty excited to see how that turned out. In the lower right corner is the seatpost collar. It also has a walnut inlay in it. And then in the upper right corner is turning on the lathe, the bar ends. Yeah, they always say from a safety perspective, you're better off not having an open end to your handlebars, and as opposed to just putting a plastic plug in there, I put the wood plugs in. And actually, that is the one thing of the bike that I still don't particularly care for. I think I have some different ideas about how I could do the bar ends. But they certainly are functional the way that they are. We have a completed bike. First ride, who knows the Keister Mill? If you're going to take out a wood, human-powered bike, why not go stop at a wooden mill? So that's where that picture on the right was taken, down at Keister Mill. The picture on the left was taken in the driveway as I rode in circles over and over and over again, asking my wife, did you get it? She did a good job, and yeah, we went with the shotgun approach. We took a lot of pictures and got one where it don't look too ridiculous. So that's the end, or is that the beginning? So here's the cool thing about building a bike. I've built, I'd say, a decent amount of furniture and projects over the years, say a bookshelf. Build a bookshelf, and then you see it as you're building it, you see it as you're applying the finish, and you kind of already know now what it's going to look like and what it's going to be like. You set it into your room, and aha, it's done. I have a good feeling of satisfaction. Look what my hands made, look what my mind imagined. But I never really walked by a bookshelf and thought to myself, oh, I can't wait to take and put a book on. I can't wait to pull a book back off. I mean, it's really not kind of part of a bookshelf. But let me tell you, you build a wood frame bike, every time I walk by it, stand here looking at it, I want to take it for a ride and go somewhere. So it's a really satisfying project in that way. So I hope that in seeing this presentation and the details and the thoughts and the efforts that went into it, that you might think about something that you could research, something that you could design, something that you could make. I see some younger people here as well, so think about it. Maybe there's an occupation involved there. Maybe it's being an electrician. Maybe it's being a carpenter, a woodworker, somebody that welds or fabricates. It could be an engineer or a designer. I really want to encourage you to think about working with your hands and working with your mind. And this is a project where I was able to use those things myself. So thanks for your interest and your attention, and feel free to come up and have a look. October of last year, and I think that it was about an 11-month project, was what I kind of calculated.
How many miles do you have?
Yeah, so far I have about 350 miles would be my guess. Then the opportunity to display it came, and that was good timing. It went in there for the month of December. I probably wouldn't ride it outside during that period of time anymore.
Would you do it again?
Damn. When do you want a wood frame bike? I think that's what's in my mind, Tom. I kind of thought that the next one maybe we'd make together for him. I can't claim it to be a terribly efficient process. I mean, not the way that I did it, and you just see like the scraps that result from it, and it has to be for a really special reason. So maybe one of the kids wants a wood frame bike someday.
Why'd you choose walnut?
Good question. Talking with Jay, it was walnut that he'd done most of his bike frames with, and he made the assessment that that is a good balance between strength and weight. Now, strength, what does that really mean? I mean, we can look up things in engineering tables. There's a lot of different ways you can define strength. I think the simple answer is I trusted with his experience in that. He's later made bikes out of some other species of wood. I think he's still come back to saying that black walnut gives that good compromise there. And then in picturing what I wanted with the leather and the certain look to it, I like the idea of the black walnut from an aesthetic standpoint.
So the finish is just that oil finish? There's no other stain or anything?
That is correct. So when you start to build those coats up, you apply the first 1, 2, 3 coats, it doesn't look so hot. And you start thinking, well, is this really going to develop some sort of gloss or sheen to it? But as they told me earlier, 4, 5, 6 coats later is when you really start to develop that gloss. And you feel it when you're wiping it with your finger. We talked about whether I'd want to put a wax over top of it, and they actually suggested no, because the wax wouldn't be as maintainable. If you needed to repair an area or touch an area up, you would need to strip a larger portion of the frame, and then you get back into that question of, well, can I match it back up? Is there always going to be an edge? So their advice was really stay with just the oil finish. Yeah, and it didn't swell up and fall apart that day I rode it in the rain. As I was riding, I was thinking to myself, well, wooden boats don't just spontaneously sink. All the bearings are sealed, and I coated everything well.
Did you say that laminates were 5/4?
Pardon me?
The boards were 5/4?
I think the boards were 4/4. I did say 5/4, I was incorrect. They were 4/4, it was like a skip planed boards. If you go down there to Yoder Lumber, they have the stuff standing up so you can actually pick and choose your boards. I thought I would buy like a rough sawn board and just take my chances, but because they had some that was already surfaced.
So you had to plane all those down to basically.
Correct, but they were resawn. So if you take a 4/4 means it's nominally 1 inch thick, and if you want to get a couple of 1/4 inch plies out of there, there's definitely waste involved. You resaw them down the middle, but then you can start to work them down and get those 1/4 inch, 6 millimeter, 5 millimeter plies.
What's your total investment?
I think, I actually looked that up today too. I weighed the bike before I came here to be prepared for that question, and then I also tried to make some assessment about the cost of things. I think it's fair to say, let's take the frame away, let's just look at the components, and I think it's probably around $1,000 for the pieces and parts, which, okay, the people that aren't experienced or involved in cycling are going, $1,000, and all the cyclists are going, yeah, $1,000. So the frame itself then, in terms of material, I mean, maybe $60 to $80 in lumber and $40 or $50 in the epoxy, but that's just a horrible, I mean, I can't even begin to put a value on it. So the other thing, I hope a lot of us, and I think a lot of us that are here tonight especially, we have an appreciation for handcrafted items, which is funny because I work for a manufacturer of mass-produced items, but at the same time, we have an appreciation for handcrafted items. And it's not just the items, it's the hands that crafted it, right? So try to put a value on it, I don't have a good, solid guess, but those were some facts I could.
Did you know the moisture content of the wood before you tried to bend it?
So, I sound like I'm making a Yoder Lumber sales pitch, but I guess I like the place. One of their claims is that their climate-controlled facility is part of having that lumber be at a nice, stable moisture content. And I know that from a lot of furniture that Dad's built, too, and he's checked it with moisture meters. They air dry and then kiln dry their lumber, and then the way that they store it, it stays at an acceptable moisture content. I can't tell you what it was for this because I honestly didn't measure it. I guess I just trusted the fact that.
I learned the hard way it's got to be high.
For what type of project were you doing?
Bending.
For bending.
Long.
Yeah.
Did you make a wood frame bike?
Can you make a comparison to strength? Say, would you say your bike frame was as strong as a steel frame or an aluminum frame?
Yeah, those are some good questions. For me, in this process, patterning off of the technique that Jay Kinzinger had used, he did the testing. I think it's ASTM and CS, CSPC testing perhaps. Those are the standards that if you buy a mass-produced bike, it needs to meet those standards. So in his engineering work, in testing a design built with this method, he's able to say that he passes those standards. I didn't scrutinize that in any way, I basically accepted that. So I think that what that tells me is that it would meet the strength, the overall strength of, a steel frame bike, for example. On that thought, that first ride, I was riding around in circles, okay, we'll see you later, head down the road. Is there cracking? Is there popping? Is there a pothole? Go easy. Lift the bike, unweight. But then, as some of you guys know, club rides, Wednesday night, I rode in the dark. I did a couple club rides in the dark. You have no idea what's coming up. And I decided that's a test to just ride. And I, at this point, my hesitation is mostly gone. So I guess I have confidence that the strength is adequate. You asked about bamboo. There are definitely some makers, and if you ever have the opportunity to go to the NABS show, Rodi will probably be there. You can check out his booth and his amazing creations. There'll be a couple bamboo guys there probably. Calfee, if you wanted to Google or look stuff up, they seem to be a prominent builder with bamboo. I think Boo Bikes is another one. I think I've recently even seen a kit. When you buy a kit and it comes with these bamboo tubes, and it comes with some sort of, I don't know if they're composite junctions, and the idea is supposed to be that you can design your frame and then assemble these. No recommendation, just saying it was interesting to see that. So there's definitely some things happening with bamboo.
Did you keep track of the hours?
I did not. Somebody at work asked me, how many billable hours do you have in that?
So you're making about $10,000 a day for it?
Yeah, probably. I don't like the idea of billable, because I guess in this case I was billing myself. I got a question you're
going to put. What do you do for a living?
Okay, everybody ready to be shocked? Surprised. I'm an engineer.
How heavy is your bike and how many inches?
The bike, when I brought it today, for the first time ever I weighed it. I know Rodi and I talked about that one time. It's like I wasn't highly focused on the weight of the bike. I'll make a few different comments here. It weighs about 24 and a half pounds. Came upstairs when I brought it here today, I stood on the scale and then I held the bike on the scale. 24 and a half is what I read there. That being said, my steel framed cross bike also weighs about 24 pounds. And Ryan knows it from some of these rides we've been out on lately. I like the feel of this better. I think it's an issue of efficiency and maybe an issue of stiffness. The wood frame and then of course the high volume tires really give a nice smooth ride. So I achieved what I was after there. It's a great, comfortable, touring type bike. The drops, we all know the drops. Oh, things are getting fast, let's go to the drops. On this bike, I'll just ride in the drops the whole time. And that was part of my design intention. I wanted no spacers up here and I wanted to be comfortable in the drops. So there's a lot of things that contribute to those different feels. But I will say this bike doesn't feel its weight, whatever that means. I think it's an issue of stiffness.
What are drops?
The drops being the curved downward part of the handlebars. So a lot of times we're riding up here because that sets you back. It's perhaps a little bit more comfortable, but it's not as aerodynamic. So we get out one of our fast-paced club rides and we decide it's time to grind on it. You go into the drops and then your lower back starts a timer. And after some period of time you realize this isn't where I want to be for too long. But on this bike, I rolled out on that first ride, and in addition to being gentle about the way that I was riding, at some point the thought popped in my mind, man, this thing just fits like it was made for me. I kind of laughed at myself going, yeah, that's because I made it for me. I never knew the advantage, I guess, of that custom designed bike, and I'm certainly no expert in designing that, but I was able to mimic what I liked about my bikes.
How many inches again?
I'd actually have to pull up a CAD drawing to give you specifics. I know that one of the key things I wanted to mimic was that saddle height. I think it was 1190 millimeters. I ride like a 59 centimeter frame on my road bike, usually a size large. But I knew, and actually I set that based off a tape measure. I set my saddle height and it's never changed since. So yeah, for the cyclist, if you got a bike that fits really great, record those numbers. Because if for some reason you have to do some maintenance or you saddle rail breaks or something, it's nice to know that you can come back to exactly where you were before. The other thing that I was interested in is maintaining a certain reach. and the geometry of the handlebars matters, and the length of the stem matters, the angle of the stem matters. So if you write down stack and reach, I don't think that's an entirely adequate way to classify a bike size and fit, but those are a couple measurements that can help with that. But it is a question, Amy.
Did you design it specifically for your size?
I did.
You took measurements?
Yeah, I didn't design it for my brother's size, so he's not allowed to ride it. I did. It was very specific for my size. Yeah, that's just a joke, because one of the days he looked at it, he had a lot of nice compliments for me and then said, okay, so I can ride it? I said, no. And he continued to ask me that as I took it away from him and put it away.
How will the wood frame handle salt?
I'm sorry, I missed the question.
How would the wooden frame handle solid snow if you rode it in the winter?
Good question. I guess I don't know for certain about that true oil finish and what effect it would have. I guess I just have a gut feeling. I don't.
Get a piece, throw it out there.
Get a piece, throw it out there. I got some scraps left over. I don't know. Does anybody have outdoor wood furniture, right? It looks really nice at first, and you put that spar varnish on there, and oh, that's the finish for an outdoor piece of furniture. And couple years later, it's horrible. So I just thinking about hanging it on the wall in the off season.
Can you tell me again the name of the design program that you use?
Yes, the CAD program is called Libre CAD. It's Libre CAD, and it's an open source CAD program, so it's free to use, like legitimately free to use. And there's a lot of videos that you can find with tutorials, and that's what I had to do to brush up on. CAD work, just to remember how to draw things and define geometries and all that. Absolutely. We talked about that earlier. Reference materials for CAD programs, CAD design.
Do you have any books on how to make a wooden bike?
I did a book display to help promote Aaron's program, and I found books on CAD, I found books on woodworking, and I found and so, in between those three books, they could probably piece together about
that. Well, that's the truth of it. I mean, I think a lot of people in Grimm are the creative and ambitious type, so yeah, go research that stuff. The library is an awesome place for that. I've always been a heavy patron, frequent visitor to the library, just whatever the topic is, and you can see how many different topics went into a project like this, but there's definitely information and resources to find. And so briefly looking at the CAD design and looking at those lamination layers, for example. And you can see everything's broken apart here on the right, with just different portions of the bike, different templates that were made, those views looking down at the chain stays and seat stays. You know, I tried to start drawing it on paper, and I mean, I don't think that's not possible. It's just because I was designing it, I wasn't just drawing it, right? I needed to understand, well, how do these different dimensions go together? So after you invest a half hour of laying things out and realize, I think I might change the head tube angle by a degree. Jeez, I mean, that there's a sales pitch for CAD, right? That's, I guess, the modern way to do it.
Aaron, you were probably noodling as you went, but I noticed when you were laying out the wood, you had it layered on top of each other. Would you have mitered those edges and put those together, the head tube and the down and seat tube, and then glue that seam as a layer?
Yep.
Okay, so that actually has a glue seam then too, because
yep. I understand your question.
Yep. Each other in a picture.
I understand your question, and no, I wasn't building them up quite like that. I used blue tape, good old blue tape, right? So when I would cut a piece and get it to have the proper fit, I would literally put blue tape, painter's tape, across the seam to hold that in position while I then worked the rest of the way around. So if you think about that triangle shape and the way those pieces went together with the joints, you can work up one direction, work across, come back, life is happy. It's that last piece, right? Like that's the one that needs to accommodate any errors that you might have had. And that was just a slow, I guess, patient type of process to really tweak those joints and get things to fit properly. Yeah, so that was all done dry. And then later, because they were all taped together, I had confidence that they would go back together and have nice fitting joints. It was a test of patience. There's a lot of tests of patience here.
besides your barns, you said you may change those. Is there anything else that you are thinking of changing?
I know somebody else can answer that question. Met with a couple guys, and they said exactly what I had always thought. So in no way did I think that was an insult. I thought it was a criticism that matched my own thoughts. I don't like the front fork. I think there's a design aesthetic that's missing there, just the way that all the lines move to the front, but then the fork is thin, I guess I'll call it. It was originally black. Did anybody catch that? Yeah, that's awesome, because I always wondered, would anybody notice that detail? It was black throughout most of the project. Then it got repainted brown. And I like the brown part better. It doesn't stand out as distinctive as black. But I think, and Rody's had some suggestions for me, some way to get a little bit more weight or some substance to the front fork. Yeah, and I'll probably turn some different bar ends just because that bugs me. Yeah, you have a question.
Could you ever couple really on it?
Oh. I don't know. We're going to try right now. No, I can't pop a wheelie on this bike, I don't think. The geometry, or the way that those different pieces go together, it makes for a really stable bike. And by stable, I mean it likes to keep the wheels on the ground. I've got two other bikes that are really good wheelie machines, though. Wheelies are good things. That's a good question. Any other questions?
Do your friends that you ride with have bicycle envy now?
I don't know, a lot of them are here. They never asked me to ride it. I guess that was a respectful issue.
We know what the answer is going to be.
Yeah, we know what the answer is going to be. No, I think part of my ambition in this presentation of the display case has just been along the way, it's just been fun to share. And, you know, it's not about the bike, remember the book, that's like the catchphrase for cyclists, right? It's a Lance Armstrong thing, it's not about the bike. Well, in this case, it's about the bike, it's about the process. Not about me necessarily, it's about come up with something, dream up some project or some idea, find some people that can help you, and yeah, dedicate to working. Do something with your hands. You don't have to stare at screens all the time. Unless you're doing CAD work, but you know.